I'm watching the flame working demonstration. At 1 o'clock, they did like an actual demonstration where he made a bunny and manipulated the glass using the hot working techniques. Now I think he's just kind of doing his own thing, not so much a demonstration. He's built up some different colors inside a clear glass. Ball. I'm not sure what this will eventually become. When I was couch surfing, I met a guy who sat at his place down in South Texas, and he had a glass making workshop in his garage. And I remember he showed it to me, and I remember seeing all these different colored sticks and not really understanding how they would be used to make glass, because what I had always seen were huge crucibles. Of molten glass. But this is a much more scalable technology and method for manipulating glass. You can't really make huge items though, but like you can with a crucible and blowing glass, like vases and things, but you can certainly manipulate glass rods to make different colored items. Back to the exhibit and finish looking around. This is all the cold casting techniques, sandblasting, stained glass, carving, and then all the hot techniques they talk about over there of manipulating the glass while it's still pliable, not molten, but not cooled yet. So I was over here in the Western history section, and then I still have to go through the history of glass, the Eastern section. We're talking about glass from Germany that they called walled glass, W-A-L-D, meaning forest, from the area in Germany tends to have a thicker shape. They use plant material in the glass making process. So it's more viscous and it tends to be thicker. But without losing its transparency. Sheet glass making, from blowing glass bubbles to mechanized processing. In the 7th century, the Syrians invented flat glass panes using crown glass technique. By the late 17th to 18th centuries, the Nordic countries gradually began to replace the crown glass technique with the cylinder glass technique, which involved the production of sheet glass by blowing cylinder. This represented a great advancement in terms of both productivity and quality. However, it was not until the invention of the E4Cult process during the early 20th century that large-scale mechanized production of flat glass became possible. In 1959, after nearly 30 years of research, the British engineer Alistair Pilkington invented the revolutionary floating glass process, which is still applied even today to make nearly all the flat glass in the world. Crown glass technique, also known as ball blowing technique, was primary method for producing glass panes until the 17th century. So you start out with a bubble, then you twist it, and kind of make a cup that flattens out eventually. Cylinder glass in the late 17th century and early 18th century. The crown glass technique was replaced with the cylinder glass technique. The production of flat glass using this method enabled a significant improvement in smoothness of the glass and production efficiency. And while there were still ripples and other defects left in the glass, productivity and quality both saw a tremendous improvement. Use a blowpipe to blow a ball and elongate it, leaving one end open. Use pliers to pull end into cylinder. Use melted something cylinder and cut other end of the glass blowpipe. Same as two, pull other end into a cylinder shape. Make a vertical incision. Use the weight of the glass and tools to open the glass. So hard to see the way they put all the verbiage on clear glass with a white, so dumb. A glass worker using cylinder glass technique. Glass worker with uncut glass. Crystal Palace. 1851, British built Crystal Palace housed the World Expo. All the glass panes used in construction were blown through the cylinder glass technique. Collection of Rakow Research Glass Museum in Corning. That's the one that burned down. Float glass. Revolutionary processes, mass production. From the end of the 18th century to the middle of the 19th century, beginning with England, the Industrial Revolution occurred throughout Europe. With the Industrial Revolution came standardization, mechanization, and mass production. The auto and building industry boomed after World War II. Plate glass was in extremely short supply. Twin grinding using worldwide to make glass consumed excessive resources and could not keep up with demand. In 1959, after nearly 30 years of research, British engineer Alistair Pilkington invented the revolutionary floating process. Pre-mixed raw materials continually move into a furnace where they are melted. E4Cult process. In the early 20th century, machines had not yet been used for the large-scale production of flat glass. In 1901, the Belgian glass worker Emile Foucault invented a machine that could pass liquid glass through a trough and pull the glass into a flat pane. This technique finally offered a means of directly and continuously producing sheet glass. While this allowed flat glass to be produced more easily, it also caused the glass to have waves or other defects. Press and blow process. In 1881, the U.S. glassworker Philip Arbogast invented the press and blow process to manufacture glass bottles, revolutionizing the traditional approach of having workers finish the bottleneck and opening in the final stages of producing a bottle. Instead, a machine would now first model the bottleneck and opening and then blow other parts of the bottle. His invention was a shift from hand-blown glass towards the automation of the industry. However, this semi-automated glass bottle machine still needed to have hot glass fed into the machine's molds by hand. Mechanized production of glass bottles from blowpipes to robotic arms. From the invention of glass blowing techniques in the first century. I thought they were playing the radio in here. They must just be playing like a CD or something. They're playing that dumb boo song now. With my boo. This was going on last night when I was trying to go through the exhibit on snuff bottles. It's like, really? In a museum, you're playing like R&B and pop music? Like, what the fuck? You can get away with maybe like elevator classical music, but it's ridiculous to be playing this in a museum exhibit. I don't know. I guess they're trying to be trendy with the whole setup of the museum with the black and... God. From the invention of glass blowing techniques in the first century till the end of the 19th century, glass bottles primarily blown manually. Having the development of the industry and technology in other industries besides glass machines to gradually place workers. Therefore, glassmakers also began trying to find means of mechanized glass blowing. You know, the sad thing about that was they're putting their own jobs on the line to be replaced by a machine. Kind of weird. Yeah, that's how I made my vase. That's the whole fun part. Seeing this hot, steamy bubble of glass take shape in harmony with your own breath. Really cool. You gotta twist it all around, tamp it. Even if it was my boo. Mechanized production of glass bottles from blowpipes, robotic arms. The IS machine. 1915, American engineer Carl Peeler invented the gob feeder. The invention of this machine represented a major breakthrough in the modernization of glass molding. Today, most of the world's bottles are produced using the IS, the individual section assembly line production machine, which utilizes Pillier's invention. Put it in, pull it out. See, it's hard to even follow some of these because they're just kind of like broken. Obviously, you have to wipe the glass clean of fingerprints every day. They're smart, they would have put this on the inside of the exhibit. Printed it all, I guess, in reverse. And put it on the inside of the exhibit. Where there's less dust accumulating, where it's not being wiped across every day and people's fingers scratching it. Arts and crafts movement, Art Nouveau and Art Deco movement, new industrial art. With the development of the Industrial Revolution, it was inevitable that there be poorly designed manufacturing products. This led to three movements in the late 19th, early 20th centuries to improve designs. Arts and crafts movement, Art Nouveau, Art Deco. Art and craft movement, 1859-1910, launched by British artist William Morris. The campaign succeeded in raising status of craftsmen and artisans, started new design trends, and paved the path for being the beginning of modern design. As a result, glass began to develop separately on two lines, industrial and art. Art Nouveau movement, 1890-1914, was an international art decoration movement represented by flowers and plants, curves. This new artistic style of working with glass demonstrated an infinite space for creation. These include the works of Louis Comfort Tiffany and Emile Gallet, fully demonstrated the new and stunning field of art and glass. The Art Deco movement was an urban cultural movement in the 1920s and 30s, which took place in countries like France and the United States. It saw countries undergo a revolution in design. The movement went particularly far and had a profound impact among French artists at the time, as they became passionate about glass design and engrossed in the manipulation of complex and rich glassmaking techniques and effects. They also began to design jewelry using glass, the results of which were most impressive. French glass artist René Jules Lalique is one of the movement's representative figures. Lalique. Let's see, William Morris, 1834 to 1896, the most important and influential designer of British architecture, furniture, and textile designs of the 19th century, also a poet, writer, and socialist, was mainly engaged in textiles, wallpaper, tiles, carpets, and stained glass and other graphic design, and was known as the father of modern design, was a representative figure of the British arts and crafts movement, and the patterns and designs, his patterns and designs had a strong Art Deco flavor. Decorative arts, drawing from nature, flowers, and plants. His works were used in church glass, carpets, textiles, and on other home accessories. Emile Gallet, representative figure of the Art Nouveau movement in France, primarily worked with glass, wood, and ceramics. His integration of his naturalistic design concept and new technology made him one of the pioneers of glass art in the late 19th century and early 20th century. His inspirations came from nature and plants and had a strong Japanese style. In France, his work called Poetry in Glass. The displayed five works by Gallet were created between 1880 and 1903 in our collections of the Corning Glass Museum. Hudson. This is in the Met, isn't it? No, it's at the Corning. Irvington on Hudson. The home of Melchior S. Belthoover. Not familiar with Emile Gallet. But he's the representative figure of Art Nouveau in France. Strong Japanese style. Louis Comfort Tiffany, of course, I know. 1848-1933, American decorative artist and glass designer, and also an exemplary representative of the new technology in the United States. In his brilliant 57 career, he created jewelry, mosaic glass, and decorated glass designs. He founded the Tiffany Studios and invented a unique texture and multifaceted spiral-shaped diamond cutting process, which gives diamonds a dazzling brilliance. The nine works were created by Tiffany from 1895 to 1920 in our collections of the Corning Glass Museum. One of the most important French glass artisans from the 19th century to the early 20th century. Who is this now they're talking about? Tiffany, French. He was decorative arts master, transcendent new art movement, Art Deco movement. Early on, he was a jewelry designer, but by the time he reached middle age, he turned to glass art. He invented a complex technique of glass coloring, cutting, and engraving, and promoted innovation in glass technology and business application. He designed perfume bottles, vases, and other high-class glass ornaments. It is for this reason he is known as the father of perfume bottle. The brand Lalique, which he founded, is known as the world's oldest and most famous brand of crystal. So I guess that's Lalique. That's weird, they don't have a name above it. René Jules Lalique. Okay, here it is. kind of weird. I guess they had it down there and they moved it up here. And it's like, I hate it when I go to a museum and there's all these problems with the verbiage and the curation. It's like, really? You built this beautiful $25 million museum. You can't get the signs right. I mean, most of the friggin' exhibit is just pictures. Shanghai, the engine to technological development for Chinese glass. Mass industrialization. Industrialized manufacturing of glass in China began during the 20th century following the establishment of the People's Republic of China as one of the most developed and centralized locations for glassmaking in China. Not only does Shanghai maintain an important position with respect to the production of household glass items, it's also become an international dealer in production of high-technology glass, including optical glass, quartz glass, light guide fiber, laser glass, Crystone glass, and bioactive glass. 1930, Shanghai Jinghua Glass Factory was the first factory which used pool furnaces and automatic machinery to produce glass containers in China. 1925, Shanghai Shishun Glass Factory produced the first domestically made vacuum flask in China. 1958, Shanghai Yaohua Glass Factory put the e-glass fiber workshop with an annual output of 500 tons in operation, marking the birth of China glass fiber industry. 1958, Shanghai Xinhua Glass Factory developed the HC Optic optical glass and opaque quartz tubes. 1962, radiation-resistant glass successfully developed in Shanghai. 1960s, first electric light source laboratory was established in Fudan University in Kaizhou. Chuan, following a lot of glass achievements used in hydrogen lamps, high pressure mercury lamp, krypton lamp, long arc xenon lamp, energy saving lamps. Let me turn my battery jacket on. 1960s, special glass materials developed in Shanghai were used in the production of China's first successfully launched missile. 1962, Shanghai Yaming Lighting Company Limited established the first production line of general lighting bulbs with an annual output of 5 million bulbs and the first line of high-pressure sodium lamps with an annual output of 100,000 units. In 1966, Shanghai No. 1 Glassware Plant created the first glass ceramic. In the early 1970s, Shanghai Institute of Ceramics created the first practical optical glass fiber in China and completed successful trial manufacture providing optical cables for China's first optical fiber communication cable. 1979, Shanghai Xinhua Glass Factory successfully developed large ultra-low expansion glass ceramics for manufacturing telescopes. 1980, Zhu Dikang, an ethnic Chinese Filipino, and his brother Zhu Dijun revolutionized the manufacturing process of glass bottles in Shanghai. With a donation of $1.25 million, the brothers were able to introduce the M. Hart Corporation's EF6 double-drop glass bottle making machine to Shanghai No. 2 Glass Bottle Factory. At the time, the most advanced bottle-making machine available. This realized great improvement in the quality of glass products in Shanghai. 1983, Shanghai Yaohua Glass Factory and Pilkington co-established a joint venture, Shanghai Yaohua Pilkington Glass Company Limited, which had the most advanced float glass production line in China. In 1983, Shanghai Picture Tube Glass Factory, designed by Shanghai Industrial Design Institute, had an annual capacity of 4 million units of 31-centimeter glass bulbs, making it the first large black and white picture tube glass bulb manufacturer. In 1990, Glass and Enamel Research Institute, a Ministry of Light Industry, Shanghai No. 2 Electric Tube Factory researched and developed the PanPixel Beam Tube Glass. The research involved manufacturing technology, including key outdoor all-weather materials and a color image display device with an ultra-large screen. This achievement made China become one of the leading countries in the world in the field of color image display technology. In 1992, Shanghai successfully developed long-range ultraviolet glass. In 1993, Australia AIC Group and Shanghai Glass Company Limited jointly founded ACI Shanghai Glass Company Limited with 0-1 patented technology and equipment. Its annual production capacity was over 450 million glass containers. In 1993, ACI Shanghai Glass Company Limited brought the advanced glass manufacturing equipment and technology of ACI and 0101 and became company which the first domestic online production line equipped with FP515 high-speed testing machine, which first produced AGR's full set of bottle quality testing equipment, blah, blah, blah. 4, Chinese microwave, fiber expert Huang Hongjia developed 8 types of special optic fibers, all of which reach international advanced levels. 95, high-tech silicate, first developed Shanghai, applied to the Shenzhou 5 spacecraft, which was the first manned space vehicle launched in China. 96, Shanghai Institute of Ceramics successfully developed the first electron scanning acoustic microscope, the performance of which reached world-class levels. 1970s until now, Shanghai Institute of Optics and Fine Mechanics was successfully developed 3 generations of laser glass. 2000, first big screen multimedia color kinescope with patent rights in China. Shangyang 21-inch multimedia color kinescope successfully developed by Shanghai Yongxing Color Kinescope Factory. 2003, Shanghai Glass Company Limited, an Italian company, Vitro Arredo, Cityvar, established a joint venture company, the Shanghai Sieves Glass Company Limited, to manufacture and develop high voltage wires with glass insulation and other types of new glass construction materials. With the establishment of this venture, China could finally start to manufacture glass insulators instead of having to import them. In 2003, SVA and the world's 5th largest LCD manufacturer, NEC, co-established a joint venture, China's first 5th generation thin film transistor liquid crystal display production line, with total investment of $8 billion, started operation. 2004, green glass with strong ultraviolet and infrared absorption properties, produced by Shanghai Yahua Pilkington Glass Company, reached advanced international levels. 2005, East China University Science and Tech successfully developed the new sub-nanosecond flash glass. 2008, Shanghai Institute of Ceramics successfully developed bioglass repair material. 2008, higher reliability pure glass spacecraft material developed by Donghua University successfully applied to the Shenzhou 7 spacecraft. 2010, Shanghai Institute of Optics and Fine Mechanics developed the thulium-doped double-clad tellurite glass optical fiber, which had 1.12 watts of laser output power on a 2-micron optical fiber, setting the current record for laser-powered output for 2-micron tellurite glass optical fiber. It was kind of interesting to follow the developments in technology on the whole, but it's a little long-winded, I guess. Now I'll go through the history in China, I guess, which is on this wall. I'll make a new video for that.